It used to always be on reruns on the telly, and I remember watching ABBA the movie thinking, these people are great. ABBA, for me, it was, you know, at the time people were listening to pop bands and girl groups, boy bands, and my sisters were really, really influenced by sort of 90s R&B, you know, TLC and Whitney Houston, all these people that I love now. But at the time I was like, my parents always remind me of this moment when I burst into the living room when I was just about 7 or 8, and I had my dressing gown on and the hood up, thinking I was God knows who, with the remote singing Dancing Queen. I think they knew something was up. I mean, I hate to be a cliche, but it was ABBA. ABBA turned me into a musical genius. I liked I Do, and Waterloo, obviously. My favourite ABBA song is SOS. I think some of their melodies are so really, really poppy and really, really interesting at the same time. And they were just pure cheese, but really good at it.
Because I think they were a folk band before they became a pop band.
And that is so apparent with some of their, you know, piano and guitar riffs. That's so catchy. And the vocals, I mean, the harmonies, you can't knock those harmonies. Which is fantastic. It's really quite easy. I moved on from ABBA, and then the Supremes. The Supremes was so in my life. It was unbelievable. I remember in year 6, I must have been 10, 11. I wrote this whole thing about how I loved the Supremes and the history of Motown. And then it was really the 60s, 70s girl groups, that sort of, you know, twee, bop sort of sound, but with that really soulful twist.
Parents buying you on CD at that point? Or?
CD, please. We would tape all the way.
Tape, cassette. Right, cassette tape.
Yeah, I mean, I always remember my sister taught me the trick of stuffing a bit of tissue down the tape and then sellotaping it over, and then so you could record off the radio. So, and I always remember recording when I heard Tight Fit, Lion Sleeps Tonight, you know, and recording it on tape and just having, just like, amazing, I've got this tape and you could just record your songs. And there's always that bit when you get the bit of the, you know, the radio presenter gabbling on about some crap. Shut up, I want this type thing. I have things in chronological order. So I obsess over certain artists.
Chronological, not alphabetical.
Not alphabetical, oh God, no. Because you've got to put it in the person that you listen to the most, your favourite artist, on my shelf straight away. That's the first thing I see. And I've got to the first thing she ever did, the last thing she ever did. And if there are singles, remember singles? Yeah. Oh, I love
cassette
this.
Single.
No, this is CD now. I'm rushing on an album, and then the single came out after the album. You know, like it does now. So it's got to be chronological in date order. I don't know why.
No. And what were you like with, sort of in this period with your friends? Were you always trying to persuade your friends to like your stuff? Or?
Yeah. Every talent show, they'd be like, obviously I was like, come on, let's do it. And we always used to do, got a bit of a reputation in school, and it was always ABBA songs. So I used to get up and I'd persuade them to, because I'd be like, we'll win if we're doing something different. Come on guys, do something different. We always. Yeah, I don't know whether it's the sheer talent or just the obscurity of three kids and a little gay boy dancing to ABBA. I mean, I don't know. No, but I remember at 12, they were all on drugs, they just listened to songs on repeat, which I understand now. Two songs in particular, Kate Bush, Wuthering Heights, classic, and Tori Amos, Leather, what's a classic. And these songs on repeat, and I remember first hearing them, and I think, you know, I really like the Kate Bush and not so much the Tori Amos. And then I listened to the rest of the Tori Amos album, Little Earthquakes, which came out in 1992, which was her first solo album. And that album changed my life. I went from, if I didn't have that album, if I had never met that artist, I still don't think I wouldn't be here. I think, you know, I'm so artistic, so creative, I would have killed myself by now, imploded. But that album kept me alive, and that's when my life started to change. So Tori Amos, Little Earthquakes, for me, is the album, you know, it's the Desert Island album. That's when things changed, and then that sprouted off into Kate Bush, although they are completely different artists. Any true fan would know that. and then from that, sprouted Bjork. So those three, I call them my holy trinity.
Right.
So, you know, it goes, well, it depends. So it's usually Tori Amos, and then Kate Bush, Bjork, you know, trying. But at times they shift to as, you know, who my favourite. Recently it was Kate Bush, Bjork, Tori, and then Bjork released Biophilia, her most recent album. So switched, and then it switched from Bjork to Tori, to Kate. So just that. So it's my holy trinity that stays. At the moment, I'm back onto Tori, which is my safe place.
Now, I haven't heard Little Earthquakes.
But then you're a fool.
That it's such a pivotal album to you. I want you to go in more detail and actually sort of go, was it a particular track? Was it even a particular chord change, a particular lyric? What? There must have been a point in that album. It wouldn't be the whole album, but something within it that really got to you.
I believe wholeheartedly, I mean, I don't know the science behind it, I don't know, you know, I think I'm spiritual and scientific on an equal level, I'm not, either way. I believe that certain songs, whatever it may be, if it's a chord, if it's a certain note, if it's a vocal, if it's the instrument, in our heads, in every single person's head, there's something that's entwined in our head from birth. And once you hear a song which will be your favourite song, no matter what, and you can hear this song every single day of your life, some days you hate it, some days you love it, but you've always got a feeling for it. I believe that people are programmed, destined, you know, the religion of music. And that when a song hits a certain note, a certain chord, it is perfect for you. And that's why it's your favourite song. You know, if you like a certain type of music, if you love drum and bass, if you love R&B, if you love classical music, it's because they're using the same components time after time, but doing different things with it. For me, Little Earthquakes by Tori Amos, track number 6, that's how obsessed I am, Happy Phantom, is the perfect song. It has everything I need to satisfy that inner, you know, the level, the whatever it is that's searching, it's got to tick every single box.
I want you to sort me through Happy Phantom then.
Well, Happy Phantom is a song about, you know, it starts, if I die today, I'll be the Happy Phantom. So, I think it's about death, it's about suicide, it's about death on many different levels. And it's perfect because if you listen to my music now and what I do, you listen to the tune, you listen to the melody, you listen to the music as a whole, you think, God, this is pleasant, this is poppy, this is, oh, I can have a dance to this. But then you listen to the lyrics, and the lyrics are the things that make you get, oh, he's talking about Myra Hindley, he's talking about, you know, trying to shag Cilla Black, he's talking about, you know, taking it out of the back box. To me, having a happy, pleasant song, something you can really, really enjoy, but having a lyrical meaning that goes deeper, which will, you know, because it's not like, I'm depressed, you listen to it a bit more. Although sometimes you want the depressive thing, but that song has influenced my music more than a lot of things. I'm not saying entirely, but the happy, playful music along with the really serious and, you know, tone, which is talks about death. I mean,
light and shade.
Yeah. I mean, it's just, it's one of those songs for me. I mean, as an album, I always think the best album that you love, that you think is your desert island album, I call it. You know, when you're stuck on a desert and all you've got is a dildo and your favourite album, you know, which one do you play with first? The album is something which, for me, the songs that you don't love, it's something that you sort of dislike, but, you know, if you're stuck on a desert island, you're going to have to like it at some point. So I'm happy that there are some songs that I think sometimes I'll skip, sometimes I'll listen to, because I know in time they're going to become my favourite song, it's going to shift. So, I mean, you think about her career, you think about what went on in her time when she went from this 80s big haired band to this first album. Stripped back, it's raw. I think that's what I like from music now. I like something where it's not just the skin, it's you're ripping back the skin and you're feeling the layers.
Wasn't she raped by a fan or something?
Yes, she was. And there's a song on the album called Me and a Gun, which is an a cappella track. And you know, I can't listen to that song. I listened to it a lot when I was younger, because I was younger and, you know, you want to listen, you want to experience the rawness, but now I can't deal with it. But songs, 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 and I hate, this is the reason popular music to me doesn't appeal to me. It's so much about the one hit song, and I don't care about that. I like an album as a whole. I'm talking to music people alike here. There is a few greater pleasures than going, you know what, goodbye for a little bit. I need to, you know, sometimes you can have 3 minutes to yourself and listen to a song, but if you want to take that hour, you know, sometimes short, sometimes longer, if you want to take that time to yourself and you get lost in the album, that's a journey that no one else has experienced. Only because it's very personal, you can experience it with other people, and they feel different things. But getting lost in an album is something which is magical, you can't replace that.
Centre all this strong female solo.
Yeah, female.
What about the sort of electro dance, rave, anything like that? Was there anything going on in dance music at the time that was attracted to you? Or again, was that your friends were into that?
No, my friends were very much into pop. Right. My family was very much into R&B, which I appreciate now more than I ever did when I was that age. But dance, I mean, I like to think my show, my music has a dance element to it. I like to get people dancing. But it's only in later years that I've really, really started to enjoy it. I mean, people like Grace Jones who fringe onto dance, Bjork fringes onto dance, an artist called Rasheed Murphy, who was originally in Moloko, again, fringes into dance. But I can't say that dance really focused much on my to listen list. I'm telling my first single I ever bought. First single I ever bought, luckily for me, was this one of the singles that actually, I used to be a very fat kid, very tubby kid, and I remember buying Believe by Cher. Probably one of the gayest things about me, you know, I like a bit of Cher, I like a bit of Liza Minnelli. Cher, Believe, and I swear to God, I went to the, you know, not went to the gym at that time, I was really young, but you know, I used to go try and do the best I could to exercise, and I lost weight, and I lost 4 stone to Cher, Believe, and I swear to God, that song was my first ever single I bought myself. You know, I was bought music, luckily, but I remember buying it, I think it was the first CD I ever bought, actually. This is when CDs were allowed, and really good song, that one.
All these strong, iconic female sort of solo singers. No bands, you do?
I think the band, it's always not a difficult subject, but I think because what I listen to and what I wanted to do as a performer and what I wanted to listen to as a fan, never, you know, no one ever had those same feelings as me when I was younger. So the idea of a solo artist doing it on their own, by themselves, to me that's what I have to do. So bands don't feature much because it was a collaboration. And I never, you know, I would have loved people to collaborate with at that time. It just never happened for me, so I think solo was the way to go.